Thanks for coming.
Yeah, thanks for having me. My name's Jamie Yount. I actually grew up in Bozeman, so nice to be back up here. And since 2002, I've worked as an avalanche technician for the Wyoming Department of Transportation, so forecasting for mostly Teton Pass, but other places, other highway corridors around Jacksonville, Wyoming. And I have a meteorology degree from the University of Utah. So, and then I teach a lot of weather classes for American Avalanche Institute with Jim Woodmansey and Mountain Weather. And so, like a big part of what I do is using really accurate weather forecasts to plan avalanche control, closures, and missions. And so I think there's a lot of value in looking at some of these products as avalanche professionals. So Doug asked me to come up here and just give a little brief talk about maybe some tips and techniques for looking at some of these weather maps. So I don't know, maybe some of you guys have shown, you've taken the weather class, right? I don't know if anybody else has, but Nick has. Yeah, great. You know, we all know weather's super complicated, and there's so many products on the internet. So you could spend hours every day looking at maps, and then you would suffer from something called paralysis by analysis. So where I'm going to try and just boil it down to really some basic things. So maybe there'll just be a bunch of review here, but maybe there'll be some little take-home things for folks, or just a few little tidbits that you can use on a daily basis. So I'm going to talk about just some considerations for avalanche forecasting, some things I've seen over the years, and just some kind of a good way to approach it, and some things to watch out for. And one other thing, since it's, you know, small group, please interrupt with questions as I go through this, instead of having them all at the end. I think that would be a lot better. So, and then I want to do a little weather review, some weather basics, and then basically talk about a forecast strategy. And it's just my forecast strategy, so there's a lot of ways to do it, but just kind of talk about what my daily routine is. So, I know what y'all want, right? You want the easy button, or you just pull out your smartphone and get the AccuWeather or the Weather Bug or whatever it is that you use. But unfortunately, I think for what we do, you need a little more. You got to refine that forecast a little bit if you wanna really put some detail into it. So. So maybe some considerations for avalanche forecasting that I think are important. The first one is kind of scaling, right? So, we're all on planet Earth. We're sitting in North America right now. We're in the Rocky Mountains. We're in the intermountain region of the Rocky Mountains. We're in Montana. Just kind of that sense of scaling. Like, what's important to Doug in the morning and the Avalanche Center guys here is more of like a mountain range scale forecast. Right, so, and then for me, I kind of forecast for specifically a mountain, like Mount Glory. So a sense of scaling there, where the detail in the forecast can be a little more broad for if you're forecasting for just a giant, larger mountain range, but for that really site-specific, even right down to a single avalanche path, where, you know, I know if the wind's blowing due west, I don't have a problem, but if it goes west-southwest, then that's enough to maybe tip things over the edge. So I think that sense of scaling is really important. And then we're already doing this, the daily observations, right, as avalanche professionals. So that's kind of a great place to start for a weather forecast, right, because you do this already. You do the daily observations, and then basically, that gives you a great starting point for a weather forecast, right? What's the weather doing right now? How's it going to change? It's either going to get better, worse, or stay the same. So, kind of two things that I think are really important that you can bring to a weather forecast is just local knowledge, right? Like, if you forecast and work in an area, you're out there, you're seeing what the weather does every day, and you develop this sense for like this pattern recognition, like just looking for things in the weather maps, trends, or certain setups that are gonna have an impact on your operation and have an impact on the avalanche forecast for the day. So I think those are really important things. And then there's a few other things in here. As I go through, I'll kind of try and point them out, but let's do a little review. So, meteorology in a nutshell, what makes weather happen? Well, the big thing is we got to lift air, right? We need vertical motion in the atmosphere. That's what makes clouds, precip, everything. So as you lift air, it cools. And as it cools, the air, moisture in the air condenses. Okay. And clouds form, and then we get precipitation. So the things I want to talk about today are just lifting. What drives lift in the atmosphere? There's certainly a lot more things than this, but these are some important ones, maybe some of the biggest ones to just focus on. So I'm going to spend a lot of time just talking about this, and then when we get to looking at some weather maps, these are the things we're looking for, is these low pressure systems. There's a lot of lift associated with just the counterclockwise rotation in the northern hemisphere of the low pressure system. Cold and warm fronts, orographics or mountains, you know, that's a big one. That's the biggest one. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about convection, but I'm definitely going to focus a lot on lift, because that's really what we're looking for when we look at weather maps. And then the faster air cools as it rises is something we call instability in the atmosphere. So the colder the air is aloft, the more unstable the atmosphere is, which just is just a function of how, basically the temperature difference between the lower elevations and the upper elevations of the atmosphere. I think since we're all mountain people, we all know that as you go increase in height, temperature decreases. So the faster that change is, the more unstable the atmosphere is in the vertical. And then, if we got moisture, that's really obviously very important. So we definitely want to be looking for that. And then, so the combination of the more lift we have with a lot of moisture, a lot of available moisture, and how unstable the atmosphere is, equals more clouds, more precip, the big dump, right, which is what we're all interested in, or one of the main things we're interested in. So let's just take a look at these lifting mechanisms. Okay, so this is just a table of, that's actually from the Avalanche Handbook, this is a great summary of these lifting mechanisms, and kind of just a sense of scaling, and also how, so cyclonic is just the counterclockwise rotation in the northern hemisphere of a low pressure system. It's a converging flow, so there's just natural vertical motion with a low pressure system, a storm. And we got frontal lift, orographics from the mountains, and convective. So a couple things to just summarize this real quick. The vertical wind speed, this is just kind of calculated. If we compare them all, 1 to 10 centimeters per second in the vertical. Frontal, another quite a bit greater, 1 to 20 centimeters per second. Orographics, anywhere from 1 centimeter to 2 meters per second, so another order of magnitude bigger. And then convective can be anywhere from 1 to 10 meters per second. If you got 10 meters per second of vertical motion, you have a tornado, probably, or very, very violent weather. And then just some precipitation rates, all over the map. And then this duration of precip is kind of interesting, right? Tens of hours to several days with these big low pressure systems. Up to tens of hours, maybe like 10 hours with a front. And then orographic can be tens of hours, but it can, if you've got a good setup for orographic, it can be days on end. And we'll talk about some of that stuff here in a bit. And then convective is really in this much smaller scale, much smaller time frame, minutes to hours. And then the scale is the last one here. So big scale here, a lot smaller here. And then the mesoscales of 10 to 100, well, whatever your mountain range size is here. And then convective is this micro scale, really small scale. So as far as forecasting difficulty, convective is the most challenging. Just because it's such a small scale, it's short-lived, so it's a really hard thing to really nail down with a forecast. The other things are more doable. And then this from the Avalanche Handbook, so percent of a total precip, and this is kind of for a full winter storm, and what kind of contribution you get from each one of these things in a winter storm. Well, the orographics is the big, obviously. So cyclonic lift, right, just that counterclockwise rotation, that's a converging flow, so that drives some vertical motion in the atmosphere. And the biggest thing I can tell you with cyclonic lift is that size matters. certainly the bigger the storm, the better, more cyclonic lift you're going to have, smaller, not so much. And then frontal lift, I think especially the cold frontal passage is really important as avalanche forecasters. And there's a couple reasons for that. A cold frontal passage, you've got probably peak precipitation rates. Okay, so you're kind of maybe 1 or 2 inches of snowfall an hour. You've got the peak wind speeds and the peak wind gusts. All right, and you've got that temperature difference right there. So as far as like natural avalanche cycles, like that's, if you're gonna see natural avalanche cycle release, cold frontal passage is a pretty likely time it's gonna happen. So I think identifying those cold fronts and when they might move through your forecast area is really, really important. And I've seen this in my operation. So just looking at hopefully this is some review, but just looking at these cold and warm fronts in two dimensions, there's a pretty distinct boundary here with the cold front, right? You've got the cold air behind it. It's a really steep boundary. You're going to have maybe a converging flow at the boundary. You've got warm air up front. It's kind of this cloud progression. It's going to be maybe these mare's tails or cirrus clouds, and then cumulonimbus at the front. There's usually some convection at the frontal boundary. And then behind the front is this these more mid-level cumulus clouds. I'm going to talk more about pre- and post-frontal setups in a minute. Warm fronts are a lot harder to identify on a map. You'll rarely see them drawn on a map, on a surface map, but they are quite prevalent. And it's basically just warm air overriding these cold air. So the front is much more gradual. It's not steep like cold frontal boundary. It's a lot more gradual, so you get this kind of steady lift with a warm front. You get a lot more mid-level clouds, more of the stratus clouds, more of this, that kind of gray sky, steady rain. You don't have the real dynamic frontal boundary. And this is a pretty kind of a classic image, I think, of a cold frontal passage, and you can almost just see the frontal boundary right here. And it can be just a very distinct frontal passage, frontal line, and very distinct weather in front and behind that. And just another table to summarize some things. I think I'm going to just skip a lot of this, but just say that with the warm fronts, the biggest thing that I can tell you to look for is the cloud progression. All right, because like I said, they're not going to be drawn on a lot of maps because they're really hard to identify. Certainly over the ocean or something where you don't have terrain, they're a lot easier to see, and you'll see them drawn quite regularly. But on for the Western United States, on a surface map, they're rarely going to be drawn. Well, I shouldn't say that, but they are not as commonly drawn, even though they are present. So the cloud progression is kind of the best. You kind of have that high mare's tails to that mid-level stratus cloud. And then during passage, you get the stratus cloud, overcast, low gray sky, steady rain. Nothing like, you're not going to have that inch or 2 inch an hour snowfall, but you just have that steady precip typically. Behind the front, it's going to be clearing. Cold front, going to be easily identified on a map. Typically, the pressure falls steadily, the atmospheric pressure, and then right at frontal passage it's the lowest, and then a sudden increase, you get this little pressure check, I'll show you an example, and then increases steadily behind the front. The wind for us in the intermountain regions is, it's almost always going to be some sort of southerly direction before the front, and then at passage, again, you're going to have peak wind speeds, peak wind gusts, and then behind the front, some sort of north to west, depends on a lot of things, but there should be some wind shift associated with that. And then the cloud progression, I kind of already talked about that. And showers ahead of the front. Well, this can be a lot of things. It could be showers ahead of the front. It could just be really windy. A frontal passage, it can be, you could have no, it could just, there couldn't be enough moisture. It might just be a lot of wind and the temperature gradient. But again, right at frontal passage, it can be really intense snowfall. So as far as natural avalanche cycles, that's kind of your peak instability time. For a lot of these dry snow avalanche events. And then showers, then clearing, but you can have a good post-frontal orographic setup, quite common. Actually, in some of the better skiing setups is usually that post-frontal, low wind speeds, cold temps, maybe that steady mountain snowfall. Maybe the snowfall is just confined to the mountains, actually. It's a really common setup. And then the temperature, warmer in front of the front, cooling suddenly, and then steady cooling behind the front. So if you're looking at actual data, it would look something like this, where you've got your atmospheric pressure. Pretty easy to identify the frontal passage, right? With that instant right there. And at frontal passage, this is wind here, where you've got the directions in the orange dots, the speed is red, the gust is in green. So right at frontal passage, you've got your peak wind speeds and your peak wind gust, gusting to 50, blowing a steady 35-ish. And you know, with all the terrain we have, there's a lot of terrain forcing, so the wind shift can be hard to identify sometimes, but there is a little bit of a wind shift here to go more westerly. And then the temperature just is steadily dropping, right? So this is actually a time series from 2004, New Year's Day to 2004, we had a natural avalanche event that actually impacted an open highway right at this time, right here. So, questions about fronts? Orographics, this is just a quick review of, as I get into maybe some weather maps, you know, the big thing for orographics is what's the flow direction for your mountain range? And this is where those things like local knowledge, scaling, really come into play, right? Because this is a really, so these are taken from David Whiteman's mountain meteorology book, and you know, this is kind of some different setups for orographics and your flow direction. So a fully perpendicular flow to your mountain range is the best setup. Oblique, okay. You know, it's not getting that steady lift over those mountain ranges. And then kind of parallel would be about the worst. Right. So, and then the concavity and the convexity, these are good setups. If you're forecasting for like right here or right there, maybe not quite as good, you know, north or south. And in these setups too, subtle changes in flow direction make a big difference. Okay. I find that like using Google Earth or really detailed maps makes a big difference in knowing your terrain and knowing how to forecast for a very complicated region, right? So I have spent the last 15 years forecasting in Jackson, and so that's what I'm most familiar with, so that's what I'm using as an example here. But you know, if I just draw a line along the ridge crest of the Tetons, it mostly runs north-south, but it's not true north-south, so the most effective flow direction for the Teton Range and my forecast area is a northwest flow. However, I do forecast for the Snake River Canyon as well, and that is a totally different setup. So if I drew my line there, now a southwest flow is the favored flow direction for the Snake River Canyon. And then the Wind River Mountain Range, really big mountain barrier. If you're in Pinedale, southwest flow, very favorable. If you're in Pinedale's just kind of right here, tucked in this notch. But if you're in Lander, on the other side of the range, which is high desert, rain shadow most of the time, but if it's northwest flow, they'll get feet. And we won't get anything in Jackson. Nothing. A trace. So, you know, I come up here to Southwest Montana. A couple things to notice in this map, too, that are pretty common, maybe makes a difference for, like, Southwest Montana here, like the Gallatin and Madison ranges, you know. The Snake River Plain is this big, smooth river basin, right? So you, a lot of these surface lows just kind of track right up this thing, you know. And so you can get a lot of southwest flow, you know, west, you know, Island Park, West Yellowstone, it's kind of this big convergence zone, you know, southwest flow up this big plain. So west, Island Park, you get a lot of snow. And, you know, that's mostly a function like southwest flow of the Snake River Plain. You know, Lone Mountain, Yellowstone Club, I'm not real familiar with it. Again, you know, it comes down to like local knowledge. I would assume maybe a good westerly flow. You know, the southwest flow probably does pretty good. I'm just kind of guessing. Bridger Bowl, right here. It'd be better to zoom in, but if you look at the Bridger Range, it's kind of cool because it's got that little convexity to it. It's hard to maybe tell in this map. Mm-hmm. But if we zoom in on Google Earth or something, and we looked at that convexity, and you know, I think we all know Northwest Flow really favors Bridger Bowl ski area. Well, Bridger Bowl is like right in the little notch of the convexity, so. You know, it doesn't, when you look at it from a big scale like this, it doesn't look like Northwest Flow is the favorable direction, but if you zoom in there and see that little convexity. So these really subtle changes are really important, and you know, local knowledge, really dialing in the flow direction, small changes in flow dimension make a big difference in precip calculations. You know, in the Tetons, we're most familiar with, Jackson Hole Mountain Resort, Teton Pass, and Targhee, all super close to each other. We all get radically different snowfall amounts during different setups. So some stages of orographic storms. Prefrontal, you know, that's that kind of mid-layer crowd. It's kind of the smallest effects of orographics. But then that frontal passage, the air becomes more unstable because of the temperature differences. Get convection, you got a lot of dynamics going on there. Post-frontal can be the best setup though for skiing, or usually you don't have the gust, you know, ahead of the front you're gonna have a lot of wind, at frontal passage you might have a lot of wind, maybe behind it some, but as things settle out, if you get in the good post-frontal setup, there's very little wind, steady snowfall, cold temps, makes for really good skiing. Maybe not. And then I think another thing to read, there's no storm required for good orographics. You could just have a good, moist, you could have the dirty ridge, we call it, right? Where you just have, you don't really have a storm system, but you have westerly flow with moisture. That's all you really need. So, and some of that, a lot of that March Madness stuff, I think was kind of that setup. There wasn't really a storm, it was just that good, steady, westerly flow. And then the last one here, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this because this isn't really a common thing in wintertime, but convective lift, sun heats the surface, air rises, cools. It hits that, and that's just a function of how unstable the atmosphere, how much lift you get. You know, this is a really common thing in this time of year, now that we have bare ground in the valleys. Any sort of winter storm you might get when there's bare ground upstream or upstream of you is going to have a lot of convection in it. Right? So really hard thing to forecast, but it can make huge differences in snowfall totals because you can get a lot of snow really quick in some sort of convective. It's not going to last long, but you could get, you know, 6 inches of snow really fast in some sort of convective type thing. And that's going to be usually confined right to that frontal passage. A lot of convection there just because of the temperature differences. And maybe one thing I didn't mention, that what makes a cold front really strong compared to weak is the amount of temperature difference between the two air masses. So, So that's kind of my quick review of what makes weather happen. I'm just going to kind of roll into my forecast strategy, how I approach it, and then we'll look at some maps. So I'm a big believer in starting with the nowcast, right? You got to really have a good, clear picture of what the weather's doing right now, the morning that you come in, do your daily obs, and using some of these maps to get a good idea, a good sense for what the weather's doing right now, because that gives you the basis for how things are going to change, right? Stay the same, get worse, or get better. Or if it's snowing, it's either going to stop snowing or keep snowing. Just that simple, right? No one's nodding. So anyhow, I think we all do this already, right? You start with the daily ops. How much snow do we get over the night? What was the max min? What's the wind direction and speed? And what's the cloud cover? And how's that going to change? And so I start with my daily observations, and then I work through this progression from here. I do satellite observations, radar, surface maps. And I kind of, I don't think any of us has a ton of time to look at this stuff in the morning. You know, certainly Jim Woodmansey, who forecasts for Jackson Hole, he spends like 3-4 hours every morning. He looks at like 150 maps. I don't have time to deal with that. You know, I'm like 30 minutes to an hour, depending on what I got going on. And so I try and be efficient. So as far as like upper air maps and models, I kind of combine those two. So that's for my intents today, that's what we're going to do. And then we'll talk about some forecast products, the models, a really powerful tool. And one of the reasons I'm big into the nowcast before I look at model stuff is I always go into it assuming that 25% of the time the model is going to be wrong, which probably is an overestimate. But you can, if you put too much faith in these things, you'll get burned eventually, and you know, that's just the way it is. So I try and have some sort of picture in my mind of what I think the weather's going to do before, you know, this is all reality, and then this is all, it's all make-believe. So that's why this is my strategy. So, and then I try and start large scale and work down to small scale. But if you're just crunched for time or whatever, you can just go straight to the small scale. If you're trying to forecast just for 24 hours, probably the small scale's a great place to start, right? But if you want to get a sense for what the next 5 days is going to be like, you really need to start with the big picture, like the whole North America, what's going on in the Pacific. If you want to just do 24 hours, you can probably just get straight to the small scale. So, but certainly like 3 days out, probably better start here. And the other thing that really dictates where I spend my time is what the avalanche problem is, right? Obviously, these things are more temperature dependent. Storm snow, I'll be more interested in just like maybe just the density change during the storm, or what if there was a change in density during the storm, or if we're gonna have one. You know, wind slab, I'm going to be more focused on my mountain winds. Persistent slab, deep slab, I'm just going to be super nervous all the time. Cornice volume, temperature, whatever, who cares about this snow. So a big thing for me, for what I do, I don't know, you guys probably are pretty familiar with Teton Pass. Super popular backcountry skiing. Kind of a challenge to manage that terrain, just the, you know, closures and people and traffic. And so I'm really interested in timing, and that comes back to cold frontal passage usually. And when's the front gonna get here? We have a lot of snow in front of the front. What's the timing? Are we gonna have, how much snow are we gonna have? When's it gonna start? When's it gonna stop? What's the density gonna be? Is there gonna be a density change? Is it gonna be right side up, upside down? And we'll look at some maps, give you guys some tools, some ideas of how to identify some of these things. You know, like I said, if there's a cold front and winds can pass, are we gonna have, and then in the springtime, is the warm-up gonna happen, and are we gonna have the overnight freeze? So then I'd be more focused on cloud cover for the night. Is there a warm front? And then mountain winds, I'm always interested in mountain winds. I actually think this is the easiest thing to forecast, though. I don't know. The models are really good at temperatures and winds. They're not great. They're pretty good. They're okay. They're good at, it is what it is, but they're good at, they're really good at temperatures and winds. Precip clouds, that's probably what they're worst at. I basically just use mountainweather.com. So everything that I look at is on Jim Woodmanson's site. And if you just go to the weather maps tab, it's basically got the progression, satellite, radar, surface maps, and then the computer models. Upper air if you want it, get that detailed. For my intentions today, I want to talk a little bit about satellite and radar, some surface map stuff, and then we'll jump to some computer model products. He's built some, go to Mountain States tab, and actually maybe I'll just kind of crank through this and we can go to the site and give you the tour. He's got some specific, he's got Montana, Idaho, he's got some specifics built in here. But I think this is a pretty good, I think this is a great place to go for anything you're interested in. So, so just a few things with satellite. You know, there is visible infrared and water vapor. In the winter, I rarely use visible unless it's like summertime, convection, thunderstorms. You know, there's just not enough daylight. The terrain's snow covered, so it looks like clouds. You can't tell. If you're gonna use this, you really gotta look at it as a loop, and you really wanna look at it like middle of the afternoon. You can see other things in the summer. It's kind of interesting, smoke, dust, smog. Kind of the go-to image, though, is the infrared image. You know, this the infrared image is 24-hour coverage. I think the important thing to remember here is it doesn't, all you're looking at is temperature. You're not, it's just the cloud temperature. So, you know, if it's super cold surface temps, then they're gonna show up in this color scale. So basically the brighter the color, the colder the temp, which means the generally the higher the cloud top. So it doesn't really tell you if it's snowing or not. Definitely doesn't tell you. But it is 24-hour coverage. It gives you kind of a sense for what the clouds are out there. So just, I'm gonna come back to this. And then there's the water vapor, which is the same thing, infrared, just tuned to a different frequency, so it sees basically all the water vapor in the atmosphere. Like this is really dry air here, and then any sort of gray. And depending on where you get these products, they're gonna have different shading schemes. I like these Weather Service ones the best. And then the brighter the color, the more water vapor is the presence. This is good just to see like different flow characteristics, storms. And these images are pretty much produced every half an hour. So every half an hour you need a new image. But basically the go-to one for me is satellite. You can get this in different scales. You know, you can get the Pacific, you can get, this is the 4 kilometer. You can get really tight intermountain region for the, with the 2 kilometer view. The 16 kilometers is going to be more the bigger picture. And again, it's just temperature. So the brighter the temperature, the colder the cloud. So generally that means the higher the cloud top. So this happens to me all the time. My bro calls me up, he's like, dude, the blob, it's coming right for us. It's gonna be epic. Are you gonna blow it tonight? You know, and I don't know, because we gotta look at a lot more. So the satellite up in the sky, looking down, and just, you know, the gray is kind of maybe that stratus level, and then just the shading dictates the temperature. So the brighter the color, the colder the cloud top, which generally means the higher it is, which could mean the thicker, it could be a thicker cloud. And if you look at these things in loops, it can be a little more easier to interpret too about what's going on. If the colors are getting brighter, then it's a sign of lift. If the colors are getting less bright, then the air is sinking. So you got satellite up in the sky looking down, and the other tool we have is radar on the ground looking up. I find a lot of people don't exactly know how radar works. So basically you have the radar at the ground, it's going around in a circle, it's sending out a beam and getting a return. It's looking for precipitation particles in the atmosphere. You can see other things too, birds, dust, but for the most part, you know, precipitation particles. So they're mostly located at weather service offices. You know, they go around in a circle and they give you a return. Couple things to know, right above the radar, doesn't see anything. And then the full scan is 19 and a half degrees. Right, so that's kind of a cross section. And this is called a volume scan coverage pattern. So if this is your radar right here, if you look at a base reflectivity, it's just gonna be this first volume scan at a half a degree tilt. If you look at composite, it's all of them together, stitched together. So the big thing to remember, this is your radar, wherever it may be, in a half a degree tilt. If you get out here to like Jackson, we're 110 miles from the Pocatello radar. We're actually right at the limit, like 120 miles, I think. So at a half a degree tilt, we are 100 miles, I'm sorry. So at a half a degree tilt, we are, and this is thousands of feet, we are almost 8,000 feet above ground level of the radar, and the radar at Pocatello is at like 4,500. So what that radar sees for precip over Jackson is at almost 13,000 feet, okay? So if it's telling me there's precip, well, I don't exactly know if that's precip at the ground. It might just be precip over the Grand Teton. So it's just really important to understand the limitations of the radar, so you kind of, well, especially in Bozeman, because you don't have any radar. So anyhow, questions about that? So base reflectivity is just the half a degree scan as it goes around, and composite is the all of them. In mountainous terrain, the beam can be blocked by the terrain, so it doesn't get a return at all. That's kind of the case here in Bozeman. You really don't have radar coverage. So this is a beam blockage diagram that you can get online for Google Earth, and this is Great Falls, which is kind of the closest one. And the blue is like perfect coverage in any sort of, and then it progresses, the brighter the color gets, the worse your coverage is. Here you have zero, and then here you have very little. Very little. That's basically, we're just going to call that zero coverage for all intents and purposes. So, kind of host. And you're right at the limit. So, if I pulled up the Billings one, it's pretty far away, and it's again, most of the beam's blocked. But for other parts of the state, I don't know, you can look at, if you want, we can pull these up and show you how to get these for your forecast area if you're curious and kind of know what the radar sees, like where the radar sees everything really well, so you kind of understand the limitations of your local radar. But it's something I look at every day, even when it's clear. Questions about radar? And then, so satellite looking down from the sky, radar looking up, and then surface maps. Which are great. I think surface maps are fantastic. I think they are incredibly hard to decipher. I feel like you need like the special meteorologist decoder ring to read these things sometimes. But I'll do my best to explain a couple of my go-to maps, and we'll go from there. So this is a composite surface map. So it's got satellite in gray, radar, which is in precipitation type. So there is a way to get the different precipitation types from the radar. So green is rain, blue is snow. Then it's got low pressure centers at the surface and cold fronts, you know, blue line with blue triangles pointing in the direction that the front is traveling. Warm fronts, red line with half circles. Occlusions are purple And I'm not going to talk about occluded fronts, but that's basically when a cold front overruns a warm front, and that's the storms typically use losing energy or losing steam when that occurs. But I do think, you know, tracking there are these little pressure systems. Remember, I was telling how these lows track right up the Snake River Plain. Well, here's a pretty good example. This lows track right up the Snake River Plain. And it's about to truss into, you know, Montana, it looks like. So kind of where these fronts go is pretty important for flow direction. So again, counterclockwise rotation around a low pressure system. This is a really generic diagram. I'm going to relate this to Western Wyoming because that's what I'm most familiar with. But as that low tracks up the plain, I'm typically going to be in southwest flow, almost always some sort of southerly, southwesterly flow. Montana probably going to be in southwest flow too, but maybe farther up here you're going to be in more of the even an easterly or northeast, depending on where you're at. And so the position of the low pressure center on the surface map dictates what flow direction you're going to have in your forecast area. And where is that low going to go? That's always a question I ask myself in the morning. Is it going to go south and skunk us because we'll be in more of the easterly flow, where Lander's going to get snow and we're going to just be... One of my least favorite things in the world is east wind, because we never get any snow and the wind never blows a little. It always blows like 50. I've come to despise it, actually. But so I always wonder, where's the low going to go? Is it going to go south, or is it going to keep tracking up the plain and go north? And maybe hard to conceptualize here, but that kind of typically put me in more of a northwesterly flow and behind the low. You got the idea. So that's just, you know, that's a question I ask myself every morning. The other go-to map I use every day is this surface off map. I'll show you where to get this from Mountain Weather. This is a map from February of 2008. But if I were going to draw a cold front in, I would draw it probably something like this. Maybe something like that. We come up here to Bozeman. I think the front's been through Bozeman. It's northwest and 37 degrees. Livingston, not quite, but it's gusting. Always hard to tell in Livingston, one of the windiest places I've checked every morning. But pretty obvious here. I think this is, I forget what this is, MUD, MUD. That's the Air Force Base, I believe. That's Boise. And then down here, you got Twin Falls and Burley. The front has been through this area, though. It's behind the front, it's northwesterly, the temperature's 34, and ahead of the front, it's southerly winds and 42 degrees. So, you know, I might look at the surface map with the fronts drawn on it, but I like to look at the obs too and just see what's going on. It's, like I said, you need a decoder ring to read these things, so I don't want to get too into the details, but, you know, just looking at the temperature and the wind can give you a sense for where the front's at and maybe how fast it's going to travel up the plain, impact Jackson, where we're 30 degrees southerly at 15 in front of the front, but when that thing passes, things might change. And same with Bozeman, where's that front at? You know, it's been through. And like behind, we get a little farther behind the front, we know it's cooling off quite a bit. It's 28 degrees in view. So just something I look at every day. There's a lot more you can get off this map, but you know, the abbreviations for precip, rain, I think I can't quite read that. Nope, snow, 2-star snow, so that's kind of pretty moderate snow. If there was 3 or 4-star snow, that would be, 4-star snow is a very heavy snowfall. 3 stars, somewhere in there between, and then it would just be dots if it was rain. This is another map I look at every day. This is the weather depiction map. So, right, you've got satellite looking down, radar looking up, a lot of these. And then this map is, I think it's called a ceilingometer. It's basically a laser at these airport stations. Weather Service offices, looking straight up in the sky, that gives you a sense for ceiling height. So this is kind of a, the Intermountain region is clear because it's reporting 500. So that means it's clear. And this circle is an indication of cloud cover. But if we go over here to the, you know, North and South Dakota, it's probably hard for you guys to read that. Again, the fronts are drawn on here, but this one is 13, so that's above ground level. So whatever the elevation of the station is, it's going to be 1,300 feet above ground level is going to be your ceiling height, and it's going to be overcast. This one in South Dakota is 2,000. You got to add two zeros to the number. So this one's 2,000 AGL above ground level. So whatever the station height is plus 2,000 would be your ceiling height, and it's overcast. This one's 3/4 covered, and it's 18,000 feet. Add two zeros. This one's overcast at 25,000 feet. It's way up there, high overcast. Just a great map to give you kind of a sense of what the ceiling heights are, how low they might be, how high they might be, give you a sense for what the cloud cover is. Look at this every day. And then the shading is actually, this is for aviation, so dark gray is instrument conditions, and light gray is marginal VFR, marginal visual flight levels. And now, so let's, a couple things with upper air maps and computer models. You know, all the times are going to be, well, so every day weather balloons are launched across the United States and all over the world, and that happens twice a day. And it happens on Greenwich Mean Time, which is GMT or UTC. So everything's kind of time-stamped to Greenwich, England, right there. And so basically what we need to know for the United States right now, we're in daylight time, so you have to subtract 6 hours. So everything's going to be in GMT. And so they launch a weather balloon at 0 GMT and at 12 GMT every day, all over the world. So they all launch at the same time, which is about, you know, 5 or 6 a.m., more than 5 and 6 p.m. And then they take all that data and they, you know, we get a lot of great maps, and we get computer models and all kinds of things. So when you read these maps, it's important to know that it's on a 24-hour clock in GMT, and to convert it to Mountain Daylight or Mountain Standard, you have to subtract 6 or 7 hours, depending on the time change. Temp's always in Celsius, winds are always in knots. And this mountain folks, like I said before, we all know that temperature decreases with height, but we also know that pressure, atmospheric pressure, decreases with height. So there's kind of some standard levels in the atmosphere that we look at, and these are them. So basically at the surface, you standard sea level pressure is 1,000 millibars, and then 5,000 feet, which is pretty much the surface, the valley floor for Bozeman and Jackson, 850 millibars, and then 700 millibars, which is like, this is the map. If I had one map, somebody said you'd only look at one map every day, this is the map I would look at, it's the 700 millibar map. Why? Because it's at 10,000 feet. My forecast area is at 10,000 feet. That's where my ridge tops are. So I want to know if they're, you know, I want to know what the flow direction is. I want to know what the wind speeds are. I want to know what the temperature is at 700 millibars. So that's 10,000 feet. 500 millibars, which is halfway, half the thickness of the atmosphere, or half of the atmospheric pressure is at that 500 millibar level, 18,000 or 20,000 feet. And then 300 millibars where the jet stream lives, that's at 30,000 feet. So 850 millibar map, if you ever look at that, is gonna basically be a surface map for the Intermountain region. 700 millibars is gonna be ridge tops, maybe not quite for Bridger Bowl, but certainly gonna be pretty good for Big Sky. And you look at these enough, you can maybe make changes as you need to, depending on the elevation. And if you were going to Denali, you would look at a 500 millibar map, potentially for summit day. Make sense? So basically we, at the different levels, kind of look for different things. And this is a really simplified version of how you could do this. But at 300 millibars, I'm pretty much only interested in the jet stream. I'm not even going to pull up a 300 millibar map today. But at 500 millibars, that's kind of the major troughs and ridges. So just like a contour map, you know, a ridge of high pressure, a trough of low pressure. Kind of what's the long wave pattern? You look at this in a big scale. If I'm forecasting, if I want to know what's going to happen 5 days out, or I want to get a sense for the long range, I'm going to look at a big scale 500 millibar map and see what kind of a pattern looks like and just get a sense for the trend. And then, like I said, the 700 millibar map is like, for avalanche forecasting purposes, this is the map, right? Okay, because this is 10,000 feet. This is right at ridge tops. So when I look at a 700 millibar map, I want to know what the flow direction is. I want to know what the temperatures are, what the temperature change might be, what kind of relative humidities we have for moisture, and then wind. And like I said, I think wind is maybe one of the easiest things to forecast. So quick thing with winds, actually. If I want to make a mountain wind forecast, I'll probably get my average wind speed off my 700 millibar map, and if I'm curious about what I think the gust is going to be, the max gust, I'll go to the 500 millibar map, and I kind of use that as a guidance for what my gust might be. Okay, so if that's something that's important, if you're trying to fly a helicopter or do something, that can be really, the gust spread can be really important. So I found that's kind of a good start. Start with the wind at 700 millibars at 10,000 feet for just your steady average winds, and then if you want your gust, see what the 500 millibar winds, and use that for guidance. And then again, 850 is basically a surface map. So I'm not going to look at it today. So here's just some really simple, you know, I think I talked about this already once. You know, it really comes down to pattern recognition with a lot of these things. So local knowledge, pattern recognition are really the two players. So if I'm curious about, you know, the five-day forecast, and I want to just pull up a 500 millibar map, and certainly this has implications for shorter-term forecasts too, just kind of identifying some of these set up. So this is a high pressure ridge. This is a huge ridge of high pressure. And so we're going to have generally nice weather. It's probably going to stick around for a while because it's so big. It's a really, you know. And so we've got a high pressure ridge over the western United States and a pretty deep low pressure trough in the eastern United States. And I can look at, you know, the models, and they can kind of tell me if this pattern's going to persist or blow out. But typically when you got a ridge that big, it takes a big storm to move it. Here's south-southwest flow. So low pressure trough. There's a little high pressure ridge right here, another little trough right here. So as this low pressure comes on shore, we are in, maybe I didn't explain flow direction very well, but wind is always parallel to these height lines. These are called isoheights. And there's temperature on here too in the dotted lines. So wind's always parallel to the isoheights. So Jackson's, western Wyoming's in southwest flow. Southwest Montana's in southwest flow in this setup. And there's a lot of temperature gradient right here because there's a lot of different temperature lines. Won't focus too much on the actual numbers at 500 millibars, but if there's a lot of gradient, pay attention. So there's a lot of, and then the closer the lines are together, the more wind speeds you're going to have. So, and here's the wind barbs. So this is a 25 knot, the triangle, and then each full barb is 10 more knots. So the actual observation is 25, 35, it's probably hard to read, but I think about 40 knots. And then northwest flow, this is something we all should pay attention to. Typical setup, high pressure off the west coast. And then, right, we got the ISO heights traveling this direction. So that's northwest flow, 25 knots. That's a really good orographic setup for a lot of us. And so I really pay attention to when I see high pressure setting up off the west coast, I know that that's probably going to drive some good northwest flow. So if there's moisture in this, which this map doesn't tell me, but one thing I didn't mention with orographics, you know, if it's blowing 50, orographics are gonna have a hard time. You know, that's not that good orographic setup we're looking for. We want like 20 knots of wind, you know, maybe 30, but we want that kind of steady wind. If it's blowing 50, it's probably just gonna be windy, and the lift's gonna be too not quite as steady and organized. Zonal flow, it's maybe a term you see sometimes in the forecast. So this is a westerly zonal flow, so all the ISO heights are just parallel, and they're westerly. Could be good, could be, you know, I don't know, if I wouldn't say bad, but could be a good snow producer. Is there moisture? Westerly flow is not a bad flow direction, could be good. And also could amplify any sort of low pressure that comes on shore later. And then the upslope storm, like the easterly flow, the other side of the continental divide. You get the low pressure system to the south, and like now Lander, the other side of the Wind Rivers, is getting like the northeast flow. They're getting hammered, and it's kind of this northerly flow. Hard to know what might be going on here, but this is, you get the low pressure tracking south in the upper level low. And, northeast flow. Remember the Mississippi River right here, I don't know, here maybe, is and then from the Mississippi all the way to the Rockies, that's gently sloping uphill, so you can get a lot of orographics on the other side of the divide. And then just a couple examples of some model forecasts or weather maps, like for 700 millibars here, to just kind of start wrapping it up. Like I said, this is the go-to map. I use the University of Utah stuff, so that's what I've always used. I really like it. I would say it's maybe not the easiest one to read, but Doug asked me to show you what I look at, so that's what you get. This is going to shade anything above 70% relative humidity. And so I just, you know, anything above 70% relative humidity on here is going to be cloud cover to some extent. Remember, I told you the thing that models struggle with is relative humidity and precip, but and those are the things we're probably most interested in. So, and then it also gives me my winds, you know, with direction and the barbs, full barbs, 10 knots each, so, and then temperatures. For Jackson, if I see -6, I know I'm going to have snow to the valley. But for Bozeman, I'd say you probably need about -8 to get snow to the valley at 700 millibars. -6, you're probably going to have, -6 Celsius, you're probably going to have rain-snow mix. Base of Big Sky, 7,000 feet? So -6 is probably snow to the base, for sure. Start seeing -4, I get worried about, and -2 or something like that. I'm really concerned about where the rain snow line's gonna be. Okay, and there's just kind of some general rules of thumb. Salt Lake City, -8 for snow to the valley floor in Salt Lake City for sure. Anything above that, some sort of mixed precip probably. And then really interested in the flow direction, 700 millibars, and the speed. So, you know, southwesterly, west-southwesterly in Jackson at 20 knots. That's maybe a pretty decent flow direction. Do we have the moisture to support it? I don't, it's not hard to say without looking at, you know, a loop and running this thing for a few more hours. These are hard to read, the timestamps down here. forecast hour. This is a NAM model. And this is actually 800 to 500 millibar relative humidities, so it's kind of through the whole layer, which is kind of nice. Temps and winds and the timestamp 2016-03, so March 21st at 12 Z, so it ran 6 in the morning, and it's a 21 hour into the future from the initial. Yeah.
Does Jim's site have any of this U of U stuff on it?
Yeah, so I thought we'd just look at a few more, and I'll just bump over to Jim's site, and we'll just give you a quick tour, and I'll show you where this is on his site.
Okay.
Yeah, it does have the links. Everything I use, you can link to from his site. So, and then really, the IR is going to be shaded orange. I like these meteostar maps, too. I think they're a lot easier to read. We'll go look to Jim's site. I'll show you where they're at. You can get a bunch of different views. You can get all the different models. You can get the big view like this. You can get the western view. You can get it to it's almost too much, but I'll show you kind of where you get this. This has got your temperature. It always the 0 degree isotherm line of constant temperature is always going to be blue on this map. And then you know, relative humidity. It's got the wind barbs on it. And it's a lot easier to read. If I had the full image, it converts the time to, I think it converts the time to Mountain Standard or daylight, which is pretty nice. So you don't have to do the, you know, conversion in your head or on your fingers. And every map you look at is going to look a little different, so you just have to spend some time getting familiar with the scale, the relative humidity, and the temperature. So you kind of got to just kind of muddle your way through these things. You know, a lot of this isn't going to mean anything to you guys, I hope. Well, maybe it does. Geopotential height, I doubt, will mean much. But, you know, temperatures in red. Anyhow, each map you look at is going to look a little different. So you just kind of got to find something you like. You get in the pattern of looking at something every day. And then surface, a preset map, they're all going to be kind of similar. They're all going to total up the preset for whatever the previous, whatever each frame of the model is. If it's 3 hours or 6 hours, it's going to be the total preset that the model thinks is going to occur at the surface for the previous 6 hours. Make sense? So if I look at a map for 21 GMT, it's going to be the preset total of 21 GMT for the previous 6 hours. What it thinks. And it's going to, this one's in tenths of inches. It's got surface winds and surface pressure. So for a 24-hour period, you'd have to maybe, for this map, each frame, you'd have to add up each for the tenths of water for storm total. Anybody ever look at these cross sections? Yeah, so I like the cross sections. It's just a different way to look at this. So the way you read these things, here's your, this is for Bozeman. Here's your pressure heights. Or your standard pressure levels, 1,000 to the surface. So here's 850, right, our surface. 700 millibars is right here. So the way you read this, you come across, and here's the date and time. So this is 2016, April 4th, from 6 GMT to April 7th at 18 GMT. And so it kind of goes this way. In time. So there's the 4th of April. I'm sure this is really hard, you can't see this, but there's the 4th of April. So this is kind of the initial reading, and then this is all the way to the 7th of April here. So it's just this full cross section all the way up to the top of the atmosphere that shows what the winds are doing. I think in this cross section, this is the 0 degree. No, I can't be. This is the 0 degree isotherm, the solid line. I don't know what the dashed one is. And then precip, what kind of precip it thinks are relative humidities you're going to see, and whether it's going to make it to the ground or not. So for mountain wind forecasting, this would be kind of an interesting map to look at, and I look at it most days. especially for things like if you got a lot of shear. I know a bridger, Randy called me one day and was like, we're having this downsloping wind event, you know, where it comes off the ridge and the wave, the mountain wave touches down like midway. And so we looked at some maps, and the only thing that stood out to us was that there was, what is that setup?
The strong north wind high and then and west wind as the surface.
Yeah, so it's a lot of shear in that setup. So a lot of north wind up high and then a lot of really significant shear. So west wind down at 700. And they've pretty much been able to dial that in. So every time they see that setup on the cross section, they know they're gonna have the significant downslope. So just, you know, you kind of look at these maps and maybe you get these little, you recognize these patterns and then you can use them in the future for forecasting. So. And then kind of the last thing here I have in my talk is this CIAC snowfall accumulation map. Anybody look at this? This is, I've been using this a lot. This is pretty nice. So it actually converts it to snowfall. And I know what you're saying. Why didn't you give me this in the beginning? But again, you know, like this is make-believe, so I think it's always good to just have a good sense for whatever else is going on before I look. So I look at this last. It's the last thing I look at every morning. I found it's really quite good, especially for 24-hour snowfall. So this gives you total snow accumulation, and it'll go 84 hours out. I'll show you where to get this. This thing's great. I would highly recommend, if you're going to use this, that you look at the precip, the same map with precip totals as well. Use them both. Don't just look at the total snowfall. And at least for where I forecast, we've had a lot of really, we've been really liking this map a lot, this product. And I know the Colorado Avalanche Information Center's really worked hard on this. They're really proud of it, so it's a good one. Any questions? Just totally melt your brain, or? So if you go to Mountain Weather, you go to the Weather Maps tab, you basically got all the things I just showed you. If you go to Mountain States, he's got a page for each state with webcams, OBS. He's got kind of a whole tab for Jackson because that's his whole place. But there's some more stuff over here. But we'll just kind of look at this Weather Maps tab. Satellite and radar, I'm not going to get into that. I think that's, but the surface maps. So each these are updated with the most current image, or they should update. The weather depiction map, that's the ceiling heights, that's right there. And the composites, right there. There's lots of different ones you can look at. I like the North American surface map as well. It gives you a bigger picture, it's a little simpler. The composite. The weather depiction maps here, this is the ceiling heights. This is updated quite frequently too, which is kind of nice. And so currently it's 6,500 AGL in, I think that's Butte. And 7,000 in broken AGL in Bozeman, above ground level. And then these in-car maps are down here. And so that's that map I showed you earlier. It shows like the Snake River Plain and kind of current temps, current winds. Pretty nice, pretty calm day. Except for in Livingston, where it's 30 gusting 44. And you can get the different views here. You can get the full Montana if you go northern Rockies. Lots of other stuff on here. These cool wind maps. I don't know if anybody ever looks at these, but they're kind of interesting. And it's got a lot of info on here. Maybe I'll show you guys just this real quick. If you go to satellite and radar, and you go to radar beam block over here in the quick links, you can get all those radar beam blockage diagrams for all the local, for Google Earth. So they're whatever those files are, the KTMs or something. So that's worth taking a look at if you're not familiar with your local radar. And lots of other products on here, weather service forecast products, which are all great, and the weather discussions, which I highly recommend people read if you want to get some feedback. The forecast discussions are quite detailed. And then the computer models. He's got these ones on here, each one's different. If you come down here to other computer model sources, these are the ones I use. So, University of Utah, CIAC, and the Meteostar, okay, are all right here. The University of Utah's kind of a complicated model. I really like it, but just so you know, it's kind of hard to read. Just ignore this one. And then this is 500 millibars with a lot of complicated stuff, vorticity and vertical velocities. But the seven, if I was going to look at this and I was not a meteorologist, I would just come down here and I would focus on, this is the 700 millibar chart and this is the surface map. Okay, I like having them next together. I like being able to compare them. I like pulling up a satellite image and seeing how well the model's capturing what the current satellite's showing for the last 4 hours. CIAC, if you click on this, it brings you to their page. You can also get to it from their Avalanche page. And then it's going to be total snow and total precip are the two. So if you click on that, it's going to load a total snow accumulation map for the Western United States. And it gives you the scale over here as far as inches. Not much in the forecast, but it'll shade these things. Remember, it's total snow, so 84 hours out, it's going to give you, it looks like Mammoth's going to get some snow. And probably blow about 100 miles an hour, too, so that'll be awesome. So those are that. And then I highly recommend making sure you look at the total precip map just to get a sense for, it's just an important piece to look at them both. And then the last thing here is we'll look at the Meteostar just really quick because they're So we'll just pull up a 700 700 millibars relative humidity, and try and load a few frames here. This GFS model, there's a lot of different models out there. They all have different limitations. GFS is a global model, global forecast system. So you can look at this for anywhere in the world. Like some of the smaller or higher resolution, this is a lower resolution model run globally. Higher resolution models are run for just small regions. All right, it doesn't convert it to mountain time, but it's a little bit, the timestamp's a lot easier to read on this thing, so it'll be -6. You read this thing, and the GFS goes 264 hours into the future. If you're making some sort of operational decision at 264 hours, wow, that's pretty much make-believe. But if you want to look that far out, just look at a 500 millibar map and get a sense for what high pressure, low pressure. That's about it. So. And then you can get lots of different views. You can get the NAM model, you can get the Western US, same, and you can select different, all kinds of things. So you can spend hours. So that's what I got. Questions? No.
So the main question we want to know is, when are you going to blow the tubes?
Bro.
Come on, bro. how do you decide, you know? Like, you're looking at your weather. You know, I'm sure you're taking snowpack structure and all that into account. But let's say you're not dealing with a bad persistent weak layer. You're just kind of dealing with
storm snow.
Are you going like an inch of water?
Yeah, certainly an inch of water and like, certainly an inch of water, but I will, it's, man, there's no hard and fast rules, you know, and I have done control work and had results with half an inch of water with the right wind direction on real slick surfaces, you know, where they're just going to be moving fast, and had results at the highway. Not big, but like size twos. So, you know, there's just no hard and fast rules. But we take the weather forecasting like super seriously, because I can't just get up at 5 a.m. and check the odds and be like, oh yeah, maybe we should control today. You know, it's too late. Like, there's already 20 cars in the parking lot, you know? So we really have to plan ahead. We really have to be like 24 hours ahead.
So your future cast is...
It's so important, yeah.
So you're kind of planning ahead, like, hey, we gotta be ready.
Yeah, and so I'm just the timing, you know, like the timing of the storm, like when's the front gonna pass? I got a lot of strategies for how I do control work up there. Like, sometimes, our standard thing is to close at 3 a.m. and shoot. But, you know, that's not always an option. You might have a persistent weak layer, the timing of the storm might not cooperate. And so we might make plans, different plans, you know, we might close at 9 p.m. We do that sometimes. And it just all depends on the timing. So it's really, really try and dial it in pretty tight. I mean, we certainly get burned on occasion, but we've had pretty good luck, so.
Yeah, I'm sure closing at noon is a different story.
Oh man, it not happening.
Yeah.
I mean, we can close, but we can't do control work. You know, so we can just close and then deal with the chaos.
just let the human triggers get here.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Free avalanche control. But certainly some powerful tools out there, you know, to even if you just looked at a few maps every day, threw it into your routine and spent, you know, a few extra minutes at some of this stuff, I think you'll find that you can dig out some little tidbits and dial in a lot of some of the, I don't know, some stuff. Any other questions? I don't know if that's a good or a bad thing.
Thanks a lot, Jamie.
Yeah.